Well, good morning. Hello, everyone, and welcome to our first New York State IPM Academic Seminar Series. For those who don't know me, my name is Alejandro Calixto. I'm the new director of the New York State IPM program. And on behalf of the IPM team, we would like to thank you for joining us today. And as well, we would like to thank Jennifer and Nicholas for accepting our invitation. What a way to kick off this seminar series. And we're excited to have you guys here today. First of all, I just want to, I would imagine that some are not completely familiar with the IPM program. And I just wanted to say a few words about our program. It is a program that has a long history and tradition in the state. It was established almost 36 years ago in 1985 through legislation added to the Ag and Markets Law. And it was mainly focusing on agricultural IPM. And in 1999, we got the support from the Department of Environmental Conservation, and we established the Community IPM Program, which was established and modeled after the Ag IPM. Our funding comes mainly from Ag and Markets and DEC, and our mission is to develop sustainable ways to manage pests and help people to use methods that minimize environmental, health, and economic risk. So just a little intro about this seminar series, and pretty much the goal, what we wanted to accomplish is to just bring all that information into our group and our system, and to increase awareness of new research and techniques that advance IPM and its adoption in all types of pest management settings. So we're gonna be talking about weeds, we're gonna be talking about insect pests, we're gonna be talking about pathogens as well, and cover different approaches to manage those pests. We're going to have these seminars on a monthly basis during the spring, every Thursday, beginning from 11:30. And this is the schedule for the seminars that we have for the spring. Today, we're, again, just delighted to have Dr. Thaler and Nicholas, who are going to talk about biological control. And our next speakers, they're going to cover topics from cultural practices for managing pests, talking about digital IPM and invasive species, and also much needed information about urban pest management. So we want to extend the invitation. Stay tuned. Come and join us. We have a tremendous lineup of speakers for the spring. And the other seminar, well, the another educational series that we have that we're launching is more for the general public. So, and it's called What's Bugging You First Fridays. And we're launching that one on March 5th. And that's gonna be also on a monthly basis. It's gonna be on Fridays just for half an hour around lunchtime. And we have a full schedule for the full year. And we're just gonna focus on those pressing issues related to pests. And since we are pretty much working virtually, what a better way just to stay connected and learn about pests and pest management from our home. So we wanna extend the invitation for you guys to join us. We have some really cool topics and cool speakers. Our first one is gonna be about spotted lantern fly, and Brian Eschner, one of our specialists, is gonna give that presentation. That is the information. There's a link for registering to those educational series, and I'll put it on the chat box. And with all that, thank you so much for joining us today. And I'm just gonna pass the microphone to Marion, and I'm gonna stop sharing.
Great, thank you, Alejandro. So I'm very excited to introduce our first speakers. If you guys wanna start sharing your screen. So the presentation is gonna go until about 12:10. We're gonna have plenty of time for questions afterwards, followed by a virtual meet and greet. So our first speakers today, speaking on the topic, fear as a biological control, how scaring farm and garden pests could lessen plant damage. We have Jennifer Thaler, who is in the Department of Entomology at Cornell University. She studies the ecological interactions between plants, herbivores, and carnivores in wild and agricultural solanaceous plant species. She focuses on understanding behavioral and phytochemical mechanisms of such tritrophic interactions, testing theory on the organization of multitrophic communities, and generating novel strategies to control insect pests. And her co-presenter is Nicholas Afflito. He is a PhD candidate in Dr. Thaler's lab studying the chemical ecology of plants, herbivores, and predators. And the goal of his research is to develop new management options that target the sensory system of agricultural pests. So thank you guys both for coming.
Well, thank you, Marion and Alejandro, for that introduction. Is everything working fine with the slides and the sound? Okay, wonderful. Well, it's really great to be here. And when Nick and I said yes to this, I had no idea that this was the first seminar. So that makes it just even more of a really nice honor to have been invited. And it's really nice to see friends and collaborators and new people on the screen here. So thank you so much. I'm Jennifer Thaler, Marion already introduced. I just wanted to give Nick the opportunity to just smile and say hello.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction, Marion, and the invitation. And it's an honor to be part of this inaugural seminar series. So thank you.
Good. So the way we're going to do this is I'm going to start and give a little bit of a general introduction to the topic, and then Nick is really going to dig into some of the details of what we've been doing in the lab recently. So as Marion said, we're talking about fear as biological control, how scaring farm and garden pests could lessen plant damage. And so you can see here the star of the show, this group of Colorado potato beetles, larvae feeding on potato plants, and they look like they're just there obliviously feeding, going about their own business. But really, they're attacked by lots of different kinds of predators, and they have to make decisions about, based on the information that they receive about those predators, what they're going to do. Are they going to keep on feeding? Are they going to hide? Are they going to run away? And what we want to know is, can we use this kind of information to enhance the effectiveness of the biological control agents, the predators and parasitoids that we're trying to use for biological control? That's the general basis of what we're talking about today. So first we'll talk about what are non-consumptive effects, what do we mean by that, and what are the implications for how we deploy biological control. I'll give you some background on non-consumptive effects of spine soldier bugs on Colorado potato beetles. We'll then talk about how important it is to understand how prey detect predators and how that can potentially lead us to some ways that we could manipulate non-consumptive effects for the future. Okay, so I just want to get started with an introduction, predation risk in tritrophic interactions. And I love it how the captioning is changing that. When Marion said it, it called tritrophic terrific interactions, which I think is a lovely typo in the translation. So I'm going to stick with that. Predation risk in terrific interactions. And so normally when we think about these systems with predators, prey, and plants, we think about how predators can consume prey, kill them, reduce their abundance, and how this can trickle down to protect plants, reduce plant damage, and increase yield. And this is the consumptive effect that we typically are trying to manipulate when we're thinking about biological control. We also want to think about this other pathway by which predators can affect prey, and that's that predators scare prey. They can change their behavior, their physiology, and that can also result in decreases of damage, predator prey feeding in different places, reduced plant damage. And this is what we're talking about when we talk about this non-consumptive effect of predators. The effect of predators that happen because they're there and because the prey respond to the predator even when they're not being eaten. And in my mind, I really got launched into this by this paper that was published in 2005. And it was a meta-analysis of many, many different systems, agricultural, terrestrial, aquatic. And what they found when they looked across all of these systems was that in over 100 studies, these fear effects of the predators on the prey were accounting for about 85% of the effect of the predators on the prey's resource. And in our case, the prey's resource is the plant, and it's what we really care about. So that really inspired me. It made me think, wow, if we want to understand how predators can be used to protect plants, we have to understand how predators are changing these non-consumptive, how predators are acting through these non-consumptive pathways. These non-consumptive pathways have been shown to be really important. They affect the abundance and diversity of plants. They've been highlighted in the conservation of ecosystems in Yellowstone. When wolf restoration, when wolves were restored to the Yellowstone ecosystem, they had all sorts of effects on riparian zones and, you know, restoration of the plant community. And a lot of those effects of wolf restoration are thought to have happened because of changes in the elk, major prey of the wolves, and how they change their behavior when they perceive that wolves are in the system. And of course, we're interested in these non-consumptive effects in terms of how they influence trophic cascades theory, how predators cause knockdown, cascading effects downward onto their prey and onto the plants. And of course, this trophic cascade is the basis for biological control. So why is this so important? What's going on here? What's really important is that, like any organism, a prey item can't do everything that it wants to maximally at the same time. So organisms have this fundamental conflict that they can either grow rapidly, eat, and get the resources they need to grow rapidly, or they can invest in defending themselves against their natural enemies. So I really like this picture, sort of cartoon of how this happens. Imagine you're a deer, you're foraging, your head is in the grass, you're not paying attention. You're very likely to die from being eaten. On the other hand, let's say you're a prey item that's very vigilant. You're paying attention or you're hiding. The problem with that is that you're likely to starve to death. You can't get enough food. So the prey are always in balancing. How much are they going to invest in acquiring food? How much are they going to invest in not becoming food for something else? And so this now gives us different levers that we can use to affect the numbers of prey and the behavior of prey. And so we think about this in terms of two pathways by which you could achieve successful biological control. And so I'm going to go down through the middle path here, which are mechanisms that lead us towards biological control being promoted. And so let's start with a prey that detects a predator in its environment. We can have one pathway where the prey responds to the predator. Maybe it reduces its feeding. That is a cost. And as long as the prey doesn't compensate for that, it will decrease its fitness and benefit, have a potential benefit for the plant. And we consider that promotion of biological control. Or we can have how we have been typically thinking about predator-prey interactions, where maybe you have a prey that detects a predator, but it doesn't respond to it. So there's no initial cost of those responses, but if the predator remains in the environment, the prey item is very likely to be eaten, killed. That decreases prey fitness and can also lead to promotion of biological control. So we want to maximize one or both of these pathways of the predator on the prey. They can both be happening at the same time. And so we can design systems that manipulate both of them potentially. What we want to avoid are the cases where the prey's response weakens biological control. That could be where you have the prey responding to the predator. Maybe it does something that's initially costly, but then it can compensate for those responses to predators and maintain its fitness even in the presence of predators. Or this consumptive pathway can fail. Maybe the prey doesn't respond to the predator, and the predator leaves without killing the prey. The prey does fine, and so biological control is weakened. So we're trying to get to this sweet spot here where either one or both, the consumptive and the non-consumptive effect, has a strong impact on the prey. So let's get in a little bit more to the nitty-gritty. How do herbivores respond to the threat of predation? And there's some really interesting systems where people have started to look at this in. When we think about our response, the human or the animal response, it's kind of our paradigm for how this works. We think about the fight or flight response. And interestingly, insects also have a fight or flight response. And I was some of you know the work of Sarah Jandrasik. She was a PhD student in the Department of Entomology, and she did a lot of work on Western flower thrips and their interactions with predatory mites. And she has some great videos. I recommend you look at her website. But these little larval Western flower thrips, when they're attacked by these predatory mites, will actually flick their tail, flick their abdomen really quickly and kind of rapidly. And you can see these predatory mites running away. It's hilarious. So that's their fight response. They also have a lot, some agricultural pests also have a flight response. So striped cucumber beetle, when they detect wolf spiders, they will run away, or in this case, fly away. They'll often fly over to a neighboring plant where the predators aren't present. And this is, there's never any shame in hiding. The fight or flight response doesn't evoke this hiding, but also work that was done by people in entomology, Du Hyung Lee, who was a PhD student, worked on this hiding response of silverleaf whitefly and how they will often move toward enemy-free space, places where the predators aren't around when they detect predators. So insects also have these very rapid, short-term responses to predators that can have effects on the plant. But it's also important to consider that predator presence can be a chronic stress for prey. And so they can have longer term responses that have big effects on their development, their physiology, their life cycle. And just one example of this that works well in pictures that we've worked on in the past is the potato aphid. When it's exposed to predators, the offspring of the aphids are much more likely to be winged. So in this case, they invest in wings. They can move away from the predator. That comes at the cost of investing in reproduction. So prey have lots of short and long-term responses. It can affect not only how much they eat, but also where they eat. And so these are potential levers that we can manipulate in agricultural systems. So Nick and I and others in the lab have focused on a system that we've grown to love, which is the prey being the Colorado potato beetle and the predator being the spine soldier bug. So many of you have grown potatoes, have been somewhat repulsed by the massive amount of damage and frass that these larval Colorado potato beetles do to plants. They're a major agricultural pest locally and in many parts of the world. The larvae do most of the damage. The adults can also do feed on the plants, and they can do damage. And here you can see just a gravid female. She's just danger in a package waiting to lay some eggs that are going to do a lot of damage. And a predator that we've been working on, it's a native predator to our region, the spine soldier bug, Podysis maculoventris. It feeds on the Colorado potato beetle larvae, and it also feeds on a lot of other soft-bodied pests. And it's interesting, I was intrigued by it because there was a lot of work that was done on it in the 80s and the 90s on making it a more economically efficient predator. It can be an effective predator. It can reduce Mexican bean beetle and Colorado potato beetle to low levels so that they're not doing economic damage. But it's expensive, and it's not really economically viable to release large numbers of these predators, although they are sold by biological control companies, as well as their pheromone has been sold in the past so that, you know, farmers, growers could bring the predators into the field in the spring. But it hasn't been super economically successful. So we've been interested in thinking about, are there ways that we could make this predator more effective at controlling prey? So we wanted to start investigating these topics by, here's a more close-up version of the stink bug. We wanted to start investigating, well, in our system, how do the beetles respond to the predators, and does it benefit plants at all? And so we did this using this kind of handy technique. This is obviously the head of the stink bug, and if you pull out its beak, you can see that there's this last segment, this darker segment. And it's basically it's the stabbing portion of how the stink bug feeds. And so what's really handy is that we can just take this beak, We can use a scalpel or a razor blade, and we can just very cleanly cut off the beak, cut off this last tip of the beak. And what that has given us is a predator that hunts its prey, but it can't pierce the cuticle of a living prey, and so it can't feed on the prey. And so you can actually see the stink bug go up to the prey, press its beak into the side of the prey, but then instead of piercing it, it slips off and, you know, the prey goes away. So the prey gets scared, it gets attacked, but it doesn't get eaten. One of the nice things about this technique is though the beak is blunt, it can't pierce the cuticle. This predator is really an omnivore, and it plant feeds, and it can continue to feed on the plant. And that plant feeding is handy because it doesn't really do economic damage. It's not a pest, that plant feeding, but it does allow the predator to stay alive and to continue acting normally. So this has been a handy technique we've been using to manipulate these scaring effects. And so what happens when we do that, when we use these risk predators? What's the effect? It allows us to isolate just this fear effect of the predator, not the consumptive feeding effect of the predator. So we started first by looking at the larvae. So what happens to Colorado potato beetle larvae when they're feeding in on individual plant cages, where it's either a control cage, so it's just the larva feeding on a potato plant, or it's the larva feeding on a potato plant in the presence of one of these risk predators, these beak-manipulated predators that can hunt but not kill the prey. And basically what we find is that causes a reduction in the amount of feeding that these larvae do. So larvae in the presence of predators eat less than if they're together, if predators are absent. So larvae feed less. I'm not going to show you the data on this, but this feeding less is a defense for the larvae. So the predators are much faster at locating larvae when they're eating. So if the larva stops eating, they're much less likely to be found and killed and eaten by the predator. So they reduce feeding as a defense against their predators. What are the consequences of this for prey fitness? So we looked at larvae who had been exposed to predators or control, not exposed to predators. We followed them through adulthood and looked at the carryover effects of that larval exposure on adult fecundity. How many eggs do they lay over their life? You can just see they lay eggs for about a month, and the control larvae, so the ones that hadn't been exposed to predators, lay more eggs than larvae that had been exposed, than adults who had been exposed to predators as larvae. So we do see that this exposure to predators does result in a decrease in the fitness of the beetles. How about the adults? I love this. This is a gorgeous picture to me of this predator-prey interaction. The adults are themselves fairly invulnerable. In the lab, they can be eaten by the predator, but generally in the field, they've got those, you know, really tough elytra wings. They can drop off the plant. They can actually run away. It's actually hilarious to watch them trying to run away from a stink bug predator. And so they're fairly invulnerable, but they still might be affected by predators, either to reduce the unlikely chance that they're going to be affected by the predator, or to protect their offspring. They don't, you know, parents don't want to put their offspring into dangerous situations. And so we studied the effect of predation risk on adults in the field. Some of you might recognize the Freeville farm, and here are some rows of potato fields, and we made plots where at the center of each plot is a plant, and it's got a bag around it. And inside that bag is a potato plant that either has a control or has some stink bug predators inside. And then we released and had naturally occurring Colorado potatoes in the environment that could colonize the plants. And then we watched how much they ate and how many eggs they laid. Okay, so first, if we look at the adult choice, we look at their colonization, simply comparing the number of adults that were in control or predation risk plots. We simply found no effect. They don't seem to, their choice of where in the field they go doesn't seem to be affected by the presence of predators. But we did find big effects on their behavior once they had chosen their spot. So adults do eat less when they're in the presence of predators, these red bars here. And perhaps even more importantly, they do lay fewer eggs on the plant. So there are fewer egg clutches and fewer total numbers of eggs on plants that have been exposed to predators. So this combination of information got us really excited about other ways that we could manipulate predation risk. Not only are the larvae feeding less, but the adults are even though the adults are relatively invulnerable, they're changing where they lay their eggs. So this really launched us into thinking, how do potato beetle larvae detect their predators? And we got interested in this question because we thought that, well, if we knew how the larvae detected their predators, maybe we could manipulate their responses to predators in the absence of actually having a lethal predator around. That could be more economically viable. And this is not a new technique. People have been manipulating what they call the scent of death for a while. And this is used a bit in vertebrate pest management. So you can actually buy a growler of predator pee. A mountain lion pee or other large carnivore pee. And if you call up the company, you can tell them, well, what vertebrate pests do I have? And they'll tell you, should you use bobcat or mountain lion or, you know, do you have javelinas or, you know, what is your pest? And then you can, I guess, scatter it around your backyard and keep these vertebrate pests away. And so we wanted to think about, well, could we use this kind of thing in pest management of smaller pests, insect agricultural pests? And we got the idea from this from some work that had been done on lady beetle aphid interactions, where really neat work showing that actually lady beetle predators, when they walk around on plants, they leave tracks, they leave odors, kind of like odors in their footsteps. And prey respond to this. In this case, aphid prey detect those odors, and they're less likely to land and accept the plants that have been exposed to just the scent of those lady beetles. So we're really excited about these odors as a possible way of manipulating prey behavior. So in this case, we're working with these stink bugs. They're called stink bugs for a name. They are stinky. And here's the adult, and it's actually lifting up its wings to release this odor, this pheromone that comes from its dorsal abdominal gland. And Nick is going to show you some more pictures of this, but this is the abdomen of the stink bug. And this gland is huge. It really takes up a lot of space in the abdomen, and they can release a lot of this odor. You might know this odor if you've interacted with stink bugs. And so our hypothesis is that we wanted to test is, are the Colorado potato beetles detecting the stink bug aggregation pheromone, because it's what they release so much of, and are they using that to make decisions on where to feed? And so we started these experiments in the lab, in an olfactometer in the lab, where we basically had beetles in petri dishes. And the beetles get air that's been blown over two odor sources. It's clean air that's been either blown over a container that has stink bugs and some wet cotton just to keep it moist, or air that's been blown over wet cotton with no predator. And so then we look to see, well, how much do they feed inside these little petri dishes if they were exposed to just the odor of the predator versus the control odor? And what we can see is that larval feeding does decrease if they're exposed to the odor from male stink bugs. And so now we're getting really excited. There does seem to be something in this odor that is affecting beetle behavior. We did some other experiments. We were interested, again, we're still in these small scale experiments, looking at whether these odors interfere with host choice, host plant acceptance. And so we put beetles into petri dishes where there's a little piece of leaf on one side, or there's on the other side of the petri dish, a leaf with a male, with the odor from the male stink bug predator. And so that's what those lines represent. And what you can see, this is looking at the percentage of beetles that choose either the leaf only or the leaf that's been dabbed with the male odor blend. And you can see that many more of them choose to go for the leaf only and avoid the male odor blend. So now I'm going to turn things over to Nick, who's going to carry forward with what we did once we really thought that, okay, there is some odor here. Now, how can we actually use this? So Nick, I will stop my share.
All right. Thanks, Jennifer, for that introduction to the system. So I'm going to kind of pick up where Jennifer left off. When I came into the lab, it's been about five and a half years ago now. I spent much of my time, hundreds of hours, in the lab on the olfactometer here that you see. And it's a really simple device. I encourage anybody interested in chemical ecology to just go buy some ball jars and some Teflon tubing and make one of these. But as Jennifer described, we just are pumping bench air through a little carbon filter, humidifying it, and then it goes to this treatment jar where we can test various combinations. And then it sends it to these replicates where there's usually an herbivore feeding on some plant material. So I was really excited about like drilling down on what specific cues, as Jennifer already discussed, were eliciting this response, because clearly it's not feasible to bag live predators in the field for a grower to scare their pests. That's not a feasible solution. So I tested different male-female combinations initially, aggregated versus single predators, the diet of the predators to look for bioactive metabolites that they're releasing. And as Jennifer alluded to, honed in on the dorsal abdominal gland. And this, as you can see here, this red region is the gland, and the male's body abdomen is largely devoted to contain this gland. Females also have a DAG, a dorsal abdominal gland, but it's about 20 times smaller, and they're much more volatilely silent than the males. So we focused here on the male dorsal abdominal gland, and we verified this by removing some of the glands and extracting them in solvent, and again, running them in the olfactometer. So in order to learn more about this gland and the development of the gland, and also to answer some questions that we had in the past where we'd run some of these trials, we'd see an effect, but then the next day we would not see the effect, and we were kind of baffled by how this variability and where that was coming in. So I really wanted to learn about the development of this gland to see if there are any clues there. And you can see here on the chromatogram on the right, on the top is a day-old, newly eclosed adult. Doesn't really contain any of the compounds that we would expect to be in there at that in that adult dorsal abdominal gland. But after about 7 days, the gland is mostly formed and contains the compounds that we would expect. And these two large spikes here are E2 hexanol and alpha terpineol. And those comprise about, I would say, 98% of the DAG contents. And there are some other minor components that I've listed here in their approximate abundance. And this is the blend that we use that I'll show you in the following projects to elicit the response. So what I've showed you was a little bit more about the physiological development of this gland, but the behavior is also an important part of this. So the predators can decide when they want to release this and when they don't want to release these odors. So we needed to characterize the behavior a bit more. And Abby Dittmar, who's at Florida State University in a PhD program now, she was a mentee in the lab at the time, helped out a lot in this project, and Todd Eugene as well, who's here at Cornell, a research scientist. And we use these sensor nodes from Iontic, which is my private company, and we build these devices. They're metal oxide sensors that data log environmental conditions, including volatile chemicals. And so as you can see here on the figure on the right, the grayed out zone is when the lights are off in the colony, and the right side is when the lights are on. And so this is the first thing we discovered in this project was that, wow, the males are only releasing these pheromones, or releasing the majority of them, in the evening. And this is counter to what we thought originally. And give us a really good clue at why maybe sometimes these assays were not seeing a response, because the males just weren't releasing this odor during that time. And again, kind of further confirming what I showed in the chromatogram in the previous slide, the young, newly enclosed adults are not releasing anything. So they're not providing an odor source as well. And also we tested some other male-female combinations and found that the females are indeed very silent, volatile, and pretty stealthy. So they're not releasing much at all, whether it's in the day or the night. And the male-female combinations didn't really seem to change the amount that was released as well. So that was another interesting thing to learn. So from this first project, we learned that the male dorsal abdominal gland was eliciting one of the strongest responses in the prey in the Colorado potato beetle. The gland is mostly comprised of 5 compounds, and it reaches its maturity at about 7 days post-eclosure. And the bugs release most of this pheromone in the evening to the early morning. So now we wanted to kind of bring this out to the field again. Jennifer talked a little bit about this, so I'll move through this part quickly since we're close on time. But we wanted to measure beetle damage, presence, oviposition, by using the live predators again for this initial test. But what we also wanted to do is expand this to go across 2 seasons, right? We've all fallen victim to seeing a strong result in the lab and getting really excited and then bringing it out in the field just to see it kind of fail. So we wanted to test it across two seasons. We use 10 spine soldier bugs as the treatment, 5 male, 5 female in each breathable bag. Here you can see on the bottom right. And quickly here, this is just the presence or absence of damage. And there's not too much exciting to look at here. On the top panel, we have 2016, and on the bottom, it's 2017. And each of these is a site visit that you see here. So really not an effect on the probability of finding damage. A little more interesting here, this is the average amount of damage per plot. It varies over the season and across seasons, but in 2016, we measured a 22% reduction in plant damage. And we saw no difference in 2017. This was a really interesting chance to capture some climactic extremes, I guess. So I don't know if anybody remembers, 2016 was a pretty extreme drought year, set records for droughts. And then 2017 couldn't be more different than that. It was very wet and we had record rainfall. So it was interesting to see how these live predators performed across these variable seasons. And that was one of the main take homes, was that these live predators are providing kind of a variable prey response. And this could be because the males are modulating this response, releasing it only at night as we learned. And also the weather is probably affecting their behavior. So then expanding on these findings, we wanted to then bring out the tests of the synthetic pheromone. So mixing this from chemicals that we can buy, readily available chemicals, and test these out in the field. So we also had to develop some release devices to administer these treatments in the field. We also tested an additional potato variety in this project. And interestingly, looked at the plant's response to the pheromone. And as you'll see, this is also an important part of this interaction. Again, back to the olfactometer. Here we were testing different release devices and finally settled on one that's very simple. It's an Eppendorf tube with an open dispersion mechanism. So it has a few half millimeter holes in the top. And that provided us a release rate that was comparable to a male spine soldier bug. So in total, we did we installed about 200 plots for this project. I'm going to show the data aggregated because it was very similar across Yukon Gold and Superior varieties. And we settled on this UV protected release device because some of the compounds are UV sensitive. So this gave us a little more longevity in the field. And again, we measured the beetle's behavior across all of their life stages and plant damage. And then we also measured some more of the plant traits like flowering time and yield. Another important part of this project, as I mentioned, the plant's role in this system, and Fiona McNeil, who is another mentee in the lab who was and is now at University of Texas in Austin in a PhD program. And in this project, we used that same pheromone blend, but we charged these rubber septa. And we did this in the greenhouse, and we enclosed a portion of the plant around this treatment source, so creating this headspace container. And we left another portion of the plant outside of that headspace container and pre-exposed the plant to those compounds for 3 days. And then after those 3 days, we removed the treatment and then removed leaves from inside and outside of the bag and let the beetles feed on them and just measure what they did. We also removed leaves for a phytohormone analysis to really drill down into what sort of changes were happening in the plant. So some of the field results I'm gonna show first. like I said, the two varieties we tested have very similar results. The adults, eggs, and larvae were all significantly, the probability of finding them were all significantly reduced in the treated plots in the field. We also saw a 31% reduction in the number of larvae in those plots that were treated, and a 46% reduction in plant damage on treated plots. So this synthetic blend was providing a much more consistent and stronger response in the predator, in the prey. There was also a marginal bump in potato yield that year. So we saw a 14% increase in the treated plots for their potato yield. And most interestingly, I think, the plants became better defended. So on the right here, you can see these two bars that were, these were leaves that were removed from inside either a control bag or a bag that had the pheromone previously in it. And then this is on the outside of the bag, kind of looking for a systemic response to the predator pheromone throughout the entire plant. And we can see here that the beetles, in the absence of any predator odors or cues, fed less on those leaves that were, on the plants that were from leaves that were previously exposed to the pheromone. So this is kind of a fascinating finding. We also found that plants that were pre-exposed to the pheromone flowered earlier than the control plants. And on the bottom here, this phytohormone panel, we can see that salicylic acid was upregulated by 36% in those treated plants. And interestingly, salicylic acid is a very common plant hormone. It's involved in regulating lots of plant physiological functions, including flowering time. So this is sort of hinting at that. But it's also related to its response to stress, biotic and abiotic. So what did we learn? We learned that there is more consistent response in these field trials and an additional potato variety using this synthetic blend versus the live predators as a cue source. We also learned that plants play a really important role in this interaction. They are upregulating salicylic acid, they have slightly higher yield, they flowered earlier, and became less palatable to the herbivore after they were pre-exposed to the pheromone. So after all this promising work, we spent some time working with a materials coordinator at NOFA, and we got the blend certified for organic use in 2020. So now it's legal and available for growers to use. And we're excited, kind of looking to the future. The lab is going to test this summer. They're going to test on a large local farm. We're going to bring this synthetic treatment out to test it on additional potato varieties, tomato, eggplant, and we're also gonna look at it in a couple different cropping systems like high and low tunnels, which we haven't done before. And there are also some really other, really interesting directions to take this as well, looking at the effects on the plants and other organisms. So we're releasing large quantities of a predator aggregation pheromone, and we wanna know, how does that affect other predators in the system that are wild? How is this affecting pollinators, since we're showing that potentially these plants are going to be flowering sooner and providing an earlier floral resource? And some of these compounds are actually antimicrobial as well. And some of Jennifer and Todd Eugene's work in the past has shown that they can increase the survival of the stink bugs by kind of cleaning their body by releasing these. So there's other interesting aspects to look at moving forward. So that's all we have. We would love to answer any questions that come up. We hope that we've inspired some interesting thoughts here. And yeah, thank you.
Great, thank you guys very much. Yeah, if anyone has questions, please unmute yourself, or you can always write them into the chat box. I'll be monitoring the chat so we can relay those questions to Jennifer and Nick.
So are you all ready to test the synthetic pheromone in your potato fields at home?
Hey, Nick, I have a question.
Hey, it sounds like Haley.
Yes. Hello. So in the last experiment you showed, maybe I just didn't quite understand the methods, but I was wondering how you could tell the difference between the insect responding to the predator pheromone versus the plant response?
That's a great. Thank you for that question. That's great. I kind of breezed through that quickly, so I'm glad you asked that. The plants were previously exposed to the pheromone, right? And then we removed all the treatments, and then we gave the beetles a leaf to eat from either a control bag or a treated bag, and measured their response. Another study that followed that up, that will be in this paper that I didn't show, kind of teased apart sort of that the indirect versus direct non-consumptive effects. So we wanted to see what part of the interaction between the predator and the prey contributes to the reduction in feeding, and what part of the interaction is coming through the plant that I just showed in that paper. And so they both can work together in unison and provide kind of an additive effect. There was a stronger effect elicited through the plant side, which is fascinating, but the actual interaction between the predator odors and the prey receiving it also induced a risk response in the prey.
Cool, thanks. Yeah, that's such a cool finding. Wow.
Nick, there's a question in the chat that I think you'll do better at answering than me, which is, Dan asked, can you talk a little bit about the NOFA certification process for your pheromone blends?
Yeah, it was actually somewhat easier than I thought it would be. They were really welcoming and easy to work with. It took some time to get the blends, like look through the EPA lists and make sure that they're going to be safe to use. And there was some back and forth between some of the other compounds that we decided to drop out of the blend that was causing some more regulatory trouble to include. So I think it's the process was fairly simple, I would say. Working with one of the material coordinators, they were great, super helpful at NOFA. And so it was just a matter of finding the right blend that kind of met the EPA requirements, but also provided the same effect that we were hoping to bring out to farms.
Here's a question from Matt Fry. Do CPB larvae produce any cues, such as alarm pheromones, when they are attacked by stink bugs? If so, are these cues produced by larvae that are probed but not injured? And can these cues be used to reduce damage? We were actually just talking about something like this at the chemical ecology multi-state meeting last week, because some species produce, the herbivores produce alarm pheromones that can be manipulated, like aphids. People have tried using aphid beta farnesene as an alarm pheromone to, elicit dropping behavior and things like that by aphids in the field. But one of the most universal scaring cues that people find in different systems is frass, not necessarily from the prey, but from the predator. So if you have a predator that has eaten, we haven't tested this for Colorado potato beetle, but we should. But if you have a predator, if you're in an environment with a predator that's eaten a conspecific, that frass, that poop becomes very scary to you. So I do actually think that could potentially be, across different kinds of systems, potentially a faster way to find a cue that works. If you can collect enough frass or poop from the predators, maybe that's a way to get the cue, as opposed to having to, for every single plant system, predator prey system, find a specific alarm coming from the prey or a specific odor coming from the predator. So I think that could be something that would be a kind of neat way to potentially find cues in different systems more quickly. Let's see. Oh, John Sanderson asks, what is the degree of the consumptive effect of podisis on CP, consumptive versus non-consumptive effect on CPB? We haven't explicitly tested that in the CPB system, Colorado potato beetle system. But the consumptive effect doesn't seem to cause, we know that it doesn't cause the whole effect. Maybe it causes 50 or 60% of the effect. in Manduca sexta, we've explicitly looked at that. We've specifically manipulated the consumptive effect by actually killing, like removing numbers, removing prey, and explicitly directly compared that to this, you know, the scaring effect. And there we find a little bit of non-additive effects, like each together reduces prey feeding on the plant by about 60% or something like that. And together they add to about 100%. So there's some redundancy in the effect.
And one thing I'll just add to that, that's an interesting question. And I think the consumptive effects are so dependent, context dependent. So if you're releasing a biocontrol in a low tunnel, you could expect a much higher consumptive effect, right? Versus a 100-acre potato field where you're just releasing biocontrol.
Yeah. Nick, maybe you want to give a hack at this one. Do you know how long the plant induction response lasts? Brian Eschenar asked that question.
Sensory system, it's much more controlled in that way. So I think in a larger scale, there's promise using these elicitors of cues. Am I breaking up? My internet's
chopping. I can hear you.
Okay.
It's interesting. We really don't know yet how long these specific cues last. We know in general that plant responses can be really brief, or they can last several weeks. But in this case, we just have started figuring out what the response is. And to be honest, I wasn't expecting it to be the salicylic acid pathway that was induced. And so those are just experiments that we need to keep working on. Brian Nault asks, seems like a greater benefit of non-consumptive effects would be to scare away pests from colonizing crops rather than causing small reductions in feeding. I agree, and that was one reason why we were really excited about the reduction in oviposition. It's not exactly scaring the pests away per se, but it is sort of reducing the number of individuals that will be there when they reduce their number of eggs. Also, have you considered taking advantage of these chemical cues to reduce transmission of pathogens by pests? We haven't worked a lot on that, but other people have, and it's very interesting, and not surprisingly, context, you know, system specific, because it really depends on how the pathogen is transmitted, because the predators are going to change the movement behavior of the prey, and that could result in more transmission or less transmission of diseases depending on how the pathogen is acquired and transmitted and things like that. So there's more that could be done with that, I agree. These are great questions. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, if there aren't any more questions, I mean, feel free to type them in. We do still have another 5 minutes or so for like a meet and greet. Obviously, questions can be asked there or just for more in-depth discussion. And Alejandro, if you want to, can you stop sharing? We'll just quickly put up our seminar series list again.
Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Nicholas. It was a great seminar. Thank you. Just wanted to a reminder for our next seminar, March 18th. We're going to have Dr. Cerruti Hooks from University of Maryland. And he is going to be talking about winter cover crops and strip tiller against different pests. And Brian Brown is going to facilitate that seminar. So we hope to see you next month. And thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you, Jennifer and Nicholas, again. That was great. Thank you.
Yes, thank you both very much. I think it was excellent. And please, anyone who wants to stay on for a few more minutes, both Jennifer and Nicholas have agreed to stay on for a few more minutes to answer any further questions.
Nick, Brian asked about your company, Iontic, and can you tell people more about that?
You're muted.
Thank you. I would have just carried on for half an hour there. Thanks for that question. A couple years ago, in my abundance of free time as a PhD student, in the nighttime, I developed some products that I couldn't find to conduct some of the research I wanted to conduct. So Iontic primarily builds tools to detect volatile organic compounds, as I've alluded to. One of the best-selling devices that we have are these micro vacuum pumps that are used to collect VOC samples through sorbent tubes and filter cassettes. And so there are others on the market, but ours are kind of different because they're extremely compact. They're rechargeable through USB, and they're field ready, so they're durable. Thanks, someone posted the website. Yeah, so if anybody's interested in any of these products, I'd be happy to talk more about them. And the device that we use for the data that I showed you is a metal oxide sensor, and it records like humidity, temperature, elevation, and the total VOCs that are present. And we adjust the sample rate, and those are also kind of field ready devices. That's kind of one of our differentiators, I guess, is they're scientific tools that are ready to be like put out into the field.
That's great. And you had spare time to do that too.
Thanks for your question.
So Nicholas and Jennifer, one quick, and maybe you guys addressed that in the presentation. So for instance, the soldier bug, when the soldier bug leaves the scent on the plant, are there differences between the host plant, let's say a tomato plant versus a potato plant, in terms of, I don't know, the concentration of that scent in that plant? Have you noticed any differences between those host plants?
Well, Jennifer might be able to answer more of the questions about tomatoes' response. We certainly are hoping this summer to expand these tests to these other solanaceous crops to look at that effect. I'm not sure. I definitely can't say for sure how that pheromone's affecting the plants. We've tested this in two potato varieties and seen this response, but I suspect we will see a similar response potentially in other solanums, since salicylic acid, if that is in fact what's being induced, is a very universal hormone. So, but maybe Jennifer can add to that. I'm not sure.
All I can add is that we know that there is a biological effect on tomato. So when we expose beet, when we have tomato as the host plant as opposed to potato, you get the same interaction where the Colorado potato beetles feed less and change their behavior in the presence of the predator, but we haven't explored mechanistically what's going on in terms of, how is the plant responding to that yet. So we need to push that side of the story forward. Yeah. I was very surprised, honestly, that there was a plant component to it. And the reason why I was so surprised is because the Colorado potato beetle is not super sensitive to induced plant responses in general. So if you take a plant, a potato or a tomato, you can and induce plants by using herbivory or using one of these elicitors, the plant defenses, you can get a plant response and you can detect effects of that on the Colorado potato beetle. But this effect, the magnitude of this effect, is much greater than the other induced responses. The other induced responses typically affect the Colorado potato beetle. So we have to investigate more about what is it that the predator pheromone is really changing in the plant.
Very cool.
Great. I think, well, we're at 12:30 now, so I want to thank both of you again. It was an excellent presentation, and thank you for being our first seminar speaker.
Thank you, Marion.
That was awesome. Make me feel to go back to grad school.
Yeah, that's interesting being at the tail end of grad school now and like looking back and being like almost nostalgic for, I'm not even done, but you know.
I want to do those cool things. I want to do those cool things. That's pretty, pretty cool. That's great work.
Thank you. Yes, this was a pleasure. I really appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jennifer and Nicola.
See you in person, so hopefully soon.
Yes,
hopefully soon. Hopefully very soon.
Bye-bye.
All right, goodbye. Thank you.